Hello. Today we're looking at how to build muscle and the three key principles to help build muscle and what the medical literature says about it all. There are a couple of areas of controversy that we're going to cover, and I'm also going to talk about my experience, who's relatively new to the game, but with a long history of running and triathlons and marathons and that sort of thing. And I'm going to give a couple of takes from what I can get as a doctor from all of this. And I think this video is, you know, great if you want to learn how to build muscle, whether you're a beginner or if you're an experienced athlete. But first, what are the three key principles of muscle gain? First, training. And in a second, we're going to go into the details of this. Second is nutrition. And the big two mentions here is protein and calories. And third is, third is the art of it all. It's being consistent, it's planning, and it's having goals that you can stick to. So first up, the training. I think the most important thing with training is just starting. There's been heaps of studies that show that, you know, any training is better than none. And the difference between different styles of training in studies is actually really hard to differentiate. This is important because for most people, just getting out there and doing it is more important than stressing about the fine details. So if you haven't started yet, don't stress. Anything you do is better than nothing. Get started. Start something you're comfortable with. Everything can change later. Okay, yeah, sure. You knew that already. Training's good. What is optimal training? The American Academy of Sports suggests for an optimal training set for muscle gain and hypertrophy, people should aim to do 8 to 12 reps of an exercise in 2 to 3 sets where the last rep feels difficult to complete. It suggests training 2 to 3 times a week and aiming for a perceived effort level of 8 out of 10. Beyond that summary statement, we get into the data, and the data is messy. Brad Currier in the British Journal of Sports Medicine this year published a meta-analysis of randomized control studies. The take-home point of this was that training with heavier loads, which they defined as greater than 80% of one rep max, seemed to increase strength faster. Doing training with multi-sets seemed to have stronger effects on hypertrophy. But there was study-to-study variation. Chris Dupofik, in a review article of Advanced Training Techniques in 2019, wrote, "Recent literature shows a much wider range of training options. Several studies have found that training with low loads, 30 to 60% of one rep max, results in similar hypertrophy to training with moderate and high loads, greater than 60% of one rep max, when volitional fatigue occurs. Moreover, reaching volitional fatigue at all times is not necessary to make significant gains in hypertrophy, especially when training with high loads is considered." My take on this is that if you're aiming for strength and hypertrophy, you should probably aim for lower reps and at higher weights. I think it is possible to get great gains at higher reps with low weights, but for example, if I'm doing shoulder presses and I'm doing it with a load that takes 20 reps to get to fatigue, I think a lot of the time I'll end up stopping at 15 reps and miss out on the, you know, true fatigue that leads to the gains. So to me,
yeah,
I think we should aim for that sort of higher load, 8 reps. I also think there's a challenge with the really, really high loads. So things where we're looking at, you know, 1 or 2 reps of nearly 100% one rep max, I think that runs a much bigger risk of What could have I done differently, and what am I trying to do now? I think the first key point for muscle gain is this needs something to turn into muscle. And I think if you run a little bit light, you need calories to turn into muscle. And this is supported in the evidence. In a review by Gary John Slater et al., they suggest that, and this is the quoted suggestion for practitioners are advised to start conservatively with an energy surplus within the range of 1,500 to 2,000 kilojoules a day, which comes out at 500 calories, and closely monitor response to the intervention using changes in body composition and functional capacity to further personalize dietary interventions. I think for me, previously being on the skinny side and trying to put on muscle, I should have aimed for an even bigger calorie excess, maybe something like 700 excess calories a day. I think for people with more optimal weight, you know, if your goal weight is 90 kilos and you weigh 90 kilos, then still running at a slight calorie excess to help build muscle is probably helpful. If your weight sits a bit high, and specifically if your body fat content is high, it can be complex. I think if the sole goal is muscle gain and weight doesn't matter, then you probably still should run at a calorie excess. If you, you know, run at a calorie deficit, that can risk losing muscle. And that's probably where people really need to concentrate on the second most important nutrient, which is protein. So the US guidelines for general public suggest that they have 0.8 grams of protein per kilo of weight. And I remember going through medical school and hearing professors talk about this and say, you know, like eating more protein just leads to expensive wee, and none of it's going to be absorbed, so it would have little impact. I think this is quite against what the current medical evidence is. In a 2022 Everson A. Noons meta-analysis, they looked at the evidence of protein in muscle gain. The short of it is aiming for 1.6 grams of protein per kilo of body weight shows significant results in improving muscle gain. The other thing that is not often well talked about in protein is absorption of protein. And things like animal products, eggs, milk, and meat have a complex mix of proteins which is complete and are well absorbed. Some vegetable sources of protein have quite poor absorption. And that's especially true for love the grains, where, you know, if bread quotes 5 grams of protein, probably the absorption is actually closer to 2.5 grams. So the take home point for myself here is I probably first need to concentrate on just increasing calories, aiming for 500 calorie excess for muscle gain. And of the macros, I think it is important to aim for well above the guidelines for you know, the general public, and aim for probably 1.6 grams of protein per kilo. I think the final thing is, and the third component of muscle gain, is really just consistency. I always remember one of my mentors in emergency used to say, there's the science of medicine and the art of medicine. And I think this is where we leave the science and get into the art. You need goals. You need to feel like you're making progress. You need to be achieving something. It needs to be fun. It needs to be social. It needs to be sustainable. If you hit the gym hard and then get injured, you're probably going to lose a lot of muscle in recovery. And I think this is where you have to play the long game and listen to your body and know when something feels wrong. You need to learn how to lift in the right way, and I still need to work on that. We need to work out what's safe for our backs and safe for our knees and safe for every other joint. So going back through it all, the three key principles of muscle gain are training, nutrition, and consistency. To build muscle, you need to train regularly, eat a healthy diet with plenty of protein, and be patient. If you follow these tips, you'll see results. So I hope you meet your goals, and I hope you have a rewarding, safe journey.